السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was sent as a blessing not only to mankind and jinnkind but to creation at large. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless him, his entire household, all his companions. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every single one of us and our offspring, those to come up to the day of Qiyamah. Brothers and sisters in Islam, we have been reading the verses of the Quran. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this opportunity. Did you know that there is no book on the globe that is read as much as the Quran? And did you know that at this moment, anywhere on the globe, there are people dedicatedly reading, reciting, learning, and engaging in all forms of contribution towards the Quran as well as learning from the Quran across the globe. No matter where we are, especially in the month of Ramadan, the miracle is all of us dedicatedly open the book. We recite it, we learn its meanings, we are interested in completing it, and we listen a lot to it. It's the only book that's a challenge. Believe me, no book can compete with this Quran as to how much it is read on a global level. So what I would like to say is, my brother, if you are not from amongst them, or my sister, don't lose out. Join the numbers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness, and may He make us from those who understand. If we are not doing it, wallahi, the rest are doing it. If you are to look at the millions and the billions, I was thinking today at iftar that there are some people reading Taraweeh already. At suhoor, there are others still reading Taraweeh. And at any given time, there are people reading all the five salawat, every single salah. Right now, there are people reading Fajr somewhere on the globe. There are some reading Zuhur right now. There are some reading Asr. There are some reading Maghrib. There are some reading Isha. There are some engaged in Taraweeh, and some have just completed Taraweeh. Alhamdulillah. We ask Allah to accept it from us. And we enjoy it, and we are earning a reward from it. Wallahi, it has in it a lot of peace, a lot of comfort. Just to listen to the Quran is the biggest peace you could have in your heart. Subhanallah. Just to listen to its beautiful rendition, recitation. Amazing. We ask Allah to grant us acceptance, to make us from those who enjoy listening to the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to love it. Our hearts need to become happy when we listen to the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That shows a connection to Allah. Because if you are connected to His word, you are definitely connected to Him. May Allah grant that to us. Surah An-Nahl, verse number 125. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of how important it is to convey the message with tact, with a lot of wisdom, and to speak to people in a polite way, to speak using the best words, to try and literally sell the product to the people. Allahu Akbar. This is when it comes to da'wah, when it comes to calling people towards goodness. You need to use the best possible methods to explain to them so that they are convinced, they can understand. Do not be harsh. Do not use hard terms. Do not become arrogant and swear people. Otherwise, people may turn away from you. Listen to what Allah says.
ادْعُ إِلَى سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي أَحْسَنُ.
Call to the way of your Rabb with lots of wisdom and with good speech, with that which is good. Whatever you want to convey, make sure that it is something good. And when you are debating or discussing, make sure that you use the best of debates, the best of discussions, beyond which there is nothing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. May He give us the ability to use the best methods to get across to the people so that the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can be understood and His message can be adopted. May we all be from amongst those who surrender to it. This we will achieve a lot of peace by, if we speak to people correctly. And inshallah, we will be able to convince many people. And imagine when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees that we are trying our best to bring in as many people towards His path. Definitely our children, may Allah make them from amongst those who are also from those. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about something very, very important that a lot of us need to go back and look at. Our parents, my brothers and sisters, Our parents, my brothers and sisters, you have a mother, an elderly mother. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make her the means of your entry into paradise. Your mother's already passed away, your dua for her. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it. May it be a dua that will grant her coolness and that will grant her entry into paradise and that will result in us also entering paradise. You have your father. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who can speak with respect. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us fulfill the role of a father, and may He make us fulfill the role of a child towards that father. Ameen. Allah has created us. He made us, no doubt. But He chose a path in order for us to come into existence. And we had no say in that. He chose it for a reason. It is a test. Who is your mother? Who is your father? That's a test from Allah. He chose the two. No matter how you were born, and no matter who were the two that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used to get together in order for you to be a result of, that is up to Allah. It is a test for you. How do you treat them? How do you react to perhaps something that happened in the home? What happens? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. All this is part of the test of Allah. If you understand that test, you achieve a lot of peace. You achieve a lot of comfort. If you don't understand it, do you know what? In Arabic, there is a saying, kama tadinu tudanu. As you do, so it shall be done unto you. May Allah protect us. So if you treat your parents with respect, even though there may be a generation gap, and this is a problem. Sometimes when you have a generation gap, perhaps more than 30 to 40 years between you and your parents, you might not think on the same level. Your thinking might be slightly different, but you need a lot of patience, you need tact, you need respect. There is no reason why you should not respect your parents. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. I know that there might be some who are saying, well, my father, he is a sodomist. May Allah safeguard us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. That father is an exception to this rule. He is in fact belonging to a group of the devil. How can a person sodomize his own children? How can a person, for example, engage in behavior that is not befitting the level of a father? May Allah protect us all from such parents. But we need to make dua for them. We need to pray for them. And we need to constantly ask Allah to forgive them. Yes, sometimes the heart is sore because of bad habits that the parents have. And because of things they may have done that really the children are so disgusted regarding. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. My brothers and sisters, this is why I said, may Allah make us from those who can be parents who are upright, so that our children can look up to us as role models. Our children can learn a thing or two. Good news to he or she who's given up a bad habit, because they now have children and they are worried this bad habit must not seep through to the next generation. Wallahi, what peace, what comfort. I know of a person, a non-Muslim. In fact, I think a total atheist, I'm not too sure, but definitely a non-Muslim. And he met me and I looked at him and I said, but have you quit smoking? He says, yes, I've actually got a child. My child is 1 week old. I said, what does that mean? He says, I'll never ever smoke. What? Now I've got a child. He says, that's gone. And I thought to myself, Ya ilaha al-alameen. People cannot quit for the sake of Allah who are Muslimin. And here they are non-Muslims quitting for the sake of their children. And they want their children really to grow up without the cigarette. Are we ready to give up the bad habit because we have children? Some people are on drugs. They introduce their children to the drugs and the two of them do it together. May Allah protect us. Really. This type of behavior is very, very bad. However, we are talking about, inshallah, the general masses. May Allah grant us goodness. We have parents. We should look up to those parents. We might have a few differences if they are minor. Wallahi, no reason to disrespect your father or your mother. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. So Allah says, verse number 23 of Surah Al-Isra.
وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا إما يبلغن عندك الكبر أحدهما أو كلاهما فلا تقل لهما أف ولا تنهرهما وقل لهما قولا كريما.
I invite you to go through these beautiful verses of the Quran, verse number 23 and those verses that follow of Surah Al-Isra, where Allah says, Allah has declared, dictated, prescribed that you shall worship none besides Him and you shall be kind to your parents. Imagine the two are coming together. Allah says, you worship none but me, and you need to be good and kind to your parents. Then Allah says, if any one of you are fortunate enough to have had one or both of your parents arrive at old age during your lifetime, never ever utter to them even uff. Uff meaning don't utter one word in rebuke. You know, they say answer back. Don't even give them that. Remember, that's your father. No matter what. Remember, that's your mother. No matter what. Respect them and understand you will earn respect. And on top of that, the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah says, لا تنهرهما. Never rebuke them. Don't repel them. Just like that. And you just toss them away as though they don't exist. And Allah says, when you talk to them, tell them that speech which is very, very respectful, full of honor. Honor them. They deserve that honor. And the verses continue where Allah says, and lower the wing of humility, which means become humble when it comes to your parents. Show that humility. Become a person really who understands, that's my father. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect it. It is reported that Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, he refused to allow his mother, in fact, he refused for himself to be on the top floor, because he said, my mother, if you are on the bottom floor, how can I be on the top? Imagine the respect he had. Obviously, this is another level altogether. And this is not only regarding one of the Sahaba. There are several narrations regarding several different companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon all of them. And the way they treated their parents. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us even a droplet of it. Remember, like we say, if it is an act of worship to resolve problems amongst Muslims, it is a greater act of worship to resolve a problem amongst family members. And if it is a greater act of worship to resolve problems amongst family members, then it is a huge act of worship to resolve a problem with your parents. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. And I want to really direct some advice to parents. My beloved parents, you need to make sure that you lead a life of goodness as well. You need to make sure that you don't do that which will result in your own child disrespecting you because of your own actions. Become responsible. Be a parent that really stands upright so you deserve the respect. Sometimes you find the mother nowhere near doing what she is supposed to be doing, and then she says, but you're not respecting me. My mom, the problem is you do not respect yourself. That's the problem. My beloved father, you don't respect yourself. You want your children to respect you. Start respecting yourself. And this is why some people say, on the globe today, there are children giving birth to children. The problem is they have not yet grown up. We don't have grown-ups who've given birth to children. May Allah make us the exception. May we be from amongst those whom, when we have children, we realize we are now on a new category. We need to become responsible, maturity, quit all those bad habits and be a person who's upright. We've spent a few moments on this because it's a very, very important subject. And at the same time, like we need to advise the children, we need to advise the parents as well. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verse number 26, وَآتِ ذَا الْقُرْبَى حَقَّهُ وَالْمِسْكِينَ وَبْنَ السَّبِيلِ. And give your relatives their right and their due. And the one who is poor and the wayfarer, give them their right. Look out for those who are poor. Reach out to them in a beautiful way, even if it is with a good word. Sometimes you might not give. You might not have enough to give everyone. You might have a small amount. So remember, at least with a good word, salamu alaykum, or at least you tell them, may Allah bless you, or inshallah, Allah grant you goodness. Whatever it is, do not rebuke a beggar. Remember that. When someone has asked you, yes, it is wrong, my brothers and sisters, to be healthy. It is wrong. You only go out begging when really it is the last resort, and there is no other way. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. But to encourage begging is wrong. And to go out begging without that valid excuse is also wrong. And to rebuke a beggar is also wrong. Look, we are trying to tackle all sides of the coin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. When I was young, we used to say both sides of the coin. As I grew up, I found out a coin has three sides. Yes, the top, they call it heads. The bottom, they call it tails. And do you know, the little side of it, the circumference of the coin, that is another side. Go and have a peep. Take a magnifying glass and you'll see it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. The reason is, one day we tossed a coin. It neither landed on the heads nor on the tails, but it stood like the wheel of a car.
So we found out it's got a third side to it. So you got to say heads or tail or wheels.
May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us.
May He grant us goodness.
So brothers and sisters, Allah then says, وَلَا تُبَذِّرْ تَبَذِيرًا إِنَّ الْمُبَذِّرِينَ كَانُوا إِخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ وَكَانَ الشَّيْطَانُ لِرَبِّهِ كَفُورًا.
Do not be extravagant and wasteful. For indeed, those who are wasteful, extravagant, they are the brethren of the devil. And the devil is ungrateful. So when you are extravagant, it is a sign of ingratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not be extravagant. What is extravagance? When you have more of what you need less of. That is extravagance. The quality is not necessarily extravagance. If I can afford a motor vehicle and I have the best motor vehicle because I afforded it, but I have one car, or perhaps if I need two types of vehicles, I've got two of them, that would not actually be a waste or extravagance for as long as I'm making use of them. But when I've got 3, 4, 5, even if it is a low model of something cheap, but more than what I actually need is waste. It's a waste. You'd rather reach out to someone else with that, and you'd rather build your paradise with that, than for you to just waste it. You know, they say one man, I don't know how true it is, but when I was studying in Medina, they said, you know, this rich Arab sheikh, he's got 7 different houses. So I looked at them and I said, but you're only allowed to have 4 wives. So they said, no, one for each day of the week. Believe me, I didn't buy the story, but if it is true, that is really a waste. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Imagine, with us, we can't even afford 7 beds to sleep on one every day. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So let's not be wasteful. Do you know why? You become a person who is very close to the devil. And then you start boasting, you start bragging, and it takes you to a whole different level. You lose the plot and you lose focus. And our focus is supposed to be upon paradise and nothing else. May Allah grant it to us. And this is why Allah says, now we know there'll be some people going home. And when your wife says, we need bread tomorrow, say, didn't you hear? Don't be wasteful. And then when they say, but we need milk for the morning, didn't you hear? Don't be wasteful, have water. So this is why you find the next few verses, Allah makes it very clear. Verse number 29, وَلَا تَجْعَلْ يَدَكَ مَغْلُولَةً إِلَىٰ عُنُقِكَ وَلَا تَبْسُطَهَا كُلَّ الْبَسْطَ. Allahu Akbar. Allah says, neither should you hold back your hand close to that neck of yours, which means you're so stingy that where you are supposed to be spending, you're not spending. Don't be like that either. And don't, what we call, don't blow. You know what? Don't actually take that money and throw it away. But choose the middle path. You spend where you are supposed to be spending. And you have to. What is the point of earning? You spend on your wife, your children, mashallah, your offspring. There is food, accommodation, clothing, and mashallah, whatever you have to. Some people, they amass wealth. And they are so stingy, to use that word, that when it comes to necessity, they don't spend. They don't spend. And when it comes to their family, they don't spend. But they can go out weekend with their friends and mashallah, so many thousands of rands are just literally, as we say, blown in the wind. And that was for their friends. And when it comes to their family, they say, no way, not at all. I earned this money hard earned. To be honest, the hadith says the best spent money is that which you have used for a morsel of food for your own family. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness and open our doors. And this is why Allah says, like we said, when a person becomes extravagant, it works on their attitude. They become haughty. And this is why Allah says, worded so powerfully, وَلَا تَمْشِ فِي الْأَرْضِ مَرَحًا. Don't walk on the earth with arrogance, haughtiness. Don't walk on the earth. Do you know how powerfully Allah has worded this? Verse number 37 and 38 of the same surah, Surah Al-Isra, Allah says, إِنَّكَ لَنْ تَخْرِقَ الْأَرْضَ وَلَنْ تَبْلُغَ الْجِبَالَ طُولًا. You want to stamp your feet and walk. You are never going to tear the earth. That's never going to happen. And you are never going to reach the height of the mountains. Never. What Allah is telling you is, we have created creatures far higher than you, and that is in the mountains, which means taller, higher than you. So even if you want to stick your nose up, it will only be 1 inch or 2, not more than that. And the mountain, go and look at it. It's far taller, far higher, far bigger. And Allah says, you want to stamp your feet. Whatever you do, you're not going to be ripping the earth. The earth will still remain the earth. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from those who stamp their feet when they walk in arrogance, nor from those who walk with their noses up in the air, becoming little Pinocchios. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us, and may He grant us goodness. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us. And He warns us again and again so many times. This verse, verse number 53 of the same surah, Surah Al-Isra. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to inform the worshippers.
وَقُلْ لِعِبَادِي يَقُولُ الَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَنْزَغُ بَيْنَهُمْ إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ كَانَ لِلْإِنسَانِ عَدُوًّا مُبِينًا.
Tell my worshippers to utter that which is the best. When they talk, they should say that which is the best. They are my worshippers. We are not worshippers of Allah. We are. So we should be uttering that which is the best. You want to say things, remember as a believer, you've got several elements to consider. Allah gave you a tongue, but on top of that He gave you a brain, and on top of that He gave you a heart, and on top of that He gave you iman. Amazing. So consider all four factors and then utter. Say the word you want to. You will never go wrong. You know why? The very next verse Allah says, because shaitan can create dissent amongst you very easily just because you did not say things properly. You want to tell someone, whether it's your child or your brother or even the one who works for you or anyone else, you want to say whatever you want to say. My brothers and sisters, if you really believe in Allah and the last day, which means the answerability of the last day, you will think for a moment before you open your mouth and you will consider what the other person will or how they will take it, how they will react, and you will consider how you are going to answer to Allah because of the utterance from your mouth, then you will talk. Can you go wrong? No, that is a true believer. This is when we will achieve peace. Speak to people with respect, no matter who they are. Search your lives. I tell you why. I sat with one of my friends and I watched him speak to some people, some of his colleagues. And then I told him, brother, please do me a favor. You speak to me with so much respect. These are your colleagues. And you speak to them with no respect at all. He said, no. You probably have just noticed something else. I told him, please do me a favor, record yourself. Because brothers and sisters, sometimes we don't realize how we come across. Record yourself. You know, sometimes you find yelling and screaming in the house. Those intelligent children of today with their iPods and iPads, do you know what they do? They record mom. And later on at night, when she's in a good mood, they replay it. I say, mom, look at what you were doing. Allahu Akbar. And she doesn't believe it. She says, no, nowadays you get this editor and all that. You must have edited it. No, mom, that's how you were talking. May Allah grant us goodness. The dads are equally, if not more guilty. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who can say good words in order to avoid the devil creating dissent from amongst us. Because Allah says the devil is indeed an outright open enemy against man. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Then again, Allah repeats a certain verse using slightly different wording to remind us of the condition of man. Verse number 83, Surah Al-Isra.
وَإِذَا أَنْعَمْنَا عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ أَعْرَضَ وَنَأَى بِجَانِبِهِ وَإِذَا مَسَّهُ الشَّرُّ كَانَ يَأُوسًا.
And here referring to those who disbelieve, obviously. When we have granted him some goodness, he turns away very far from us. He turns away. He forgets us completely. You find the disbelievers, when they have a lot, sometimes it happens to the hypocrites. May Allah protect us all. When they have a lot and they've been given so much, they turn far away from Allah. They live a life of do whatever you want. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And Allah says, then when a little bit of evil or difficulty touches the person, he becomes totally in despair. Completely loses all hope. So Allah says, amazing. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, all this is a test for you to realize that your wealth and your children and whatever you have, you're going to be leaving it all here. It's only your deeds that you will take with you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you goodness. May Allah protect us. Then we read Surah Al-Kahf. I'm sure you heard the end of it today. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the reward of having listened to the words of the Quran. For every letter, there is a reward. This surah, Surah Al-Kahf, has a lot in it. We need to read its meaning. We need to understand the examples and parables drawn by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He speaks of some youth, youngsters who were worried about the condition of the environment and the tyrant ruler. And because of that, they decided to go away into a rural area. They went into a cave and they made a dua to Allah. Listen to what the dua was. They wanted peace. They wanted peace in the dunya and in the akhirah. They wanted to be away from tyrants and people who were calling them towards that which was wrong. And they wanted to earn the pleasure of Allah. So they went into a cave. Imagine. And they asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
رَبَّنَا آتِنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا رَشَدًا.
Oh Allah, this is verse number 10 of Surah Al-Kahf. Oh Allah, oh our Rabb, we ask you, مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً, we want from you mercy, and we want you to help us. We want you to create for us within our affairs that of guidance, which means guide us in all our affairs, Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we want mercy from you. So Allah says, we answered their prayer, we answered their call, we gave them the guidance, and we were merciful upon them. By doing what?
فَضَرَبْنَا عَلَىٰ آذَانِهِمْ فِي الْكَهْفِ سِنِينَ عَدَدًا.
We sealed their ears in the grave for several years. From this we learn that whatever you hear sometimes can snatch away your peace. When you hear things that are bad, when you hear stories of immorality, when you hear swear words, and when you hear that which is futile, it can affect you very, very badly. This is why they say, hear no evil, see no evil, do no evil. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us protection. Wallahi, if you are going to look at it, your mind interprets it. You know, the brain you have is far more sophisticated than a computer. So it processes what you have seen. It processes what you have heard within a flash. And you don't realize it stores it in the mind and it affects the heart straight away. So when you see it once, twice, three times, the processing changes depending on your level of spirituality, because spirituality is affected positively or negatively depending on whether you have seen something good or something bad. When you see 200 people crying reading the Quran, wallahi, if you watch it one day, 2 days, 5 days, after that there will be 201, because you will be joining them. Your mind will process it and you will feel like, I need to be one. You come, for example, to a program of this nature once, twice, and you see thousands of people, you won't want to miss out. Even when you're outside, you're going to say, let me go there even if I catch the 5 minutes of it. You want to feel it because you know something good I'm seeing. It's affecting me positively. I'm hearing something. You hear it once, twice, 10 times, it affects you positively or negatively depending on what it is. So if you go out with a group of people who are drinking, the first day you say, Astaghfirullah. Second day you might say, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. You know? Fourth day you say, A'udhu billah. The fifth day you look at them and say, very bad. The sixth day you say, these friends of mine, no way. And the seventh day, 1 week later, you're sitting with them and laughing. You forgot to say, A'udhu billah. You forgot to say anything. And now you are watered down, completely watered down. One wonders, a month later, a new friend might come and look at you and say, Astaghfirullah. May Allah protect us. Really, it can happen because you are watching things, you are hearing things. Allah says, we bless these youngsters, youth, by blocking their ears. So my brothers and sisters, do not listen to that which is evil. Do not watch or see that which is evil. You know, there are some newspapers on the globe, we have to say this because it's a reality, some websites as well, full of gossip. What they do, they promote vice, whether you know it or not, whether they know it or not. They have juicy stories. People pay 10 rands for a normal paper, they'll pay 20 for that one. Why? They want to hear the juiciest stories. This person had that, they broke up with this, that one did this, this one committed adultery in that way, this one stole this way, that one wore this type of clothing, this one, that happened, that one, this happened. And everyone wants to know everything. So what happens? Our life automatically degrades itself. Our spirituality drops because we look at things and we start thinking everybody's on this low level. But brother, you've been reading a paper that probably depicts only 10% of society. May Allah protect us. This is why the best thing, read that which is going to be beneficial. Read that which is good for you. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will have mercy on you. And remember one thing, you really want the peace? Look at these youngsters. They didn't just go there and say, okay, now we're away from all this, you know, whatever negativity there was. They made a dua, oh Allah, oh Allah, oh our Rabb, we want your mercy. So let's also make the dua, oh Allah, we want your mercy. Oh Allah, we ask you to grant us the mercy, the peace. Ya Allah, guide us, protect our ears, protect our eyes, protect our children, our offspring. Allahu Akbar. Continue making the dua. There are people better than us who did not suffice by merely sitting away from that which was bad, but they made a dua to Allah regularly to protect them from that which was bad. So it's not good enough for us to just stay away. Stay away, and on top of that, ask Allah to keep you away. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. This is what we learn from the Quran. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that whenever you say you would like to do something in the future, tomorrow, later on, always utter the term inshallah. Inshallah. By the will of Allah. I will inshallah come back here tomorrow, like we say until we meet again tomorrow, inshallah. Don't worry, I haven't ended. But what I mean is, that's what we always say, by the will of Allah, because tomorrow I might not be here. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So Allah says, verse number 23 and 24 of Surah Al-Kahf,
وَلَا تَقُولَنَّ لِشَيْءٍ إِنِّي فَاعِلٌ ذَلِكَ غَدًا إِلَّا أَن يَشَاءَ اللَّهِ وَاذْكُرْ رَبَّكَ إِذَا نَسِيتَ.
Allah says, do not say that you are going to do something tomorrow or in the future, except after saying inshallah or saying inshallah with it, which means by the will of Allah. And whenever you have forgotten, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So inshallah, and this time I'm serious, until we meet again, inshallah, we say wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad, subhanallah bihamdihi, subhanaka allahumma bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.